It takes a lot of energy to fly. And so philosophically, you might wonder, why bother? Watching an animal do something completely crazy, like a pirouette in air, like acrobatics or things like that, it really broadens your horizons in terms of like what is physically possible. That's like the number one kind of lesson that I've gotten from doing research, is just the world is way more crazy than I ever had anticipated. And I don't think I'll ever be done being curious about it.
Researcher Vikram Baliga of the University of British Columbia studies the anatomy and movement of animals. He's especially fascinated with flight, how a bird flies, and how their bodies allow them to do things man-made flying machines can't.
There's reports of certain species that can basically stay aloft for like months at a time, and they just kind of like dip down occasionally to get food. They can kind of like sleep with half a brain on and relying on like winds and currents to kind of keep them going. There's a few hundred species of hummingbirds, and their wings can go crazy fast. 40 times a second to like 100 or 120 times a second. Flight is when an animal is flying, you know, like a bird or a bat or an insect. They are very much responsible for generating the forces to keep themselves up, you know, in the sky. They have to do it entirely with their wings. We're still trying to understand exactly all the different things that it takes to be a flyer and be able to power your own kind of flight.
To really understand how bird wings twist and flex, Vikram needs to manipulate them with his own hands. Living birds wouldn't work, so he turned to the dead ones kept in a museum.
In the first few weeks that I was here, I went over there and just played around with a few cadavers. Like there was a few like duck wings. I'd never really played with a duck wing before. It's like a very foreign object to me. Birds essentially have wrists and they have elbows, and it was principally those two joints that we focused on. Just because we wanted to see within the wing, you know, what the wing is capable of doing, what the range of shapes the wing can take is, and how that might correspond to a certain style of flight or not. This is the wrist, and so the bird is kind of like sitting like that, with its hand coming down this way, forearm over here, and then the elbow is kind of tucked away in the back. Birds that soar a lot, like turkey vultures or eagles or albatrosses, they have a lot of limitations in terms of what their joints can do. There's a lot of like locking up of the wing in certain positions, and that helps them stabilize as they're gliding around in these like, you know, high force environments.
But this research can teach us more than just about how and why different birds fly. It offers insight for how humans might better create our own flight designs.
To what extent we can apply this knowledge to help design better, you know, automobiles or aircraft or robots or things like that. Evolution has basically done these natural experiments, and it's interesting to think about how that might be able to help us. So we wanted to design aircraft that had adaptable wings, that if a sudden gust of wind like hit an airplane and the airplane could suddenly just sort of like change its wing shape to accommodate, we can draw some inspiration from nature and see what nature has already tried and what has or hasn't worked. And so I ultimately hope that, like, as I continue my career as a scientist, I can keep having those kinds of moments where I can look in places where other people may not have thought to look, or where it might feel stupid to look, but then you realize that there really is something there.